Morning, Rhoda.
Morning, Daddy.
Up and dressed and ready for the day? Wearing your best perfume?
Yes, I am, Daddy.
That's right. This is the day of the picnic. I hope there's a breeze off the water.
Miss Fern says there always is.
She says it never rains on the 1st of June, too. Don't count on it.
Are you leaving today, Daddy?
The plane goes in an hour. Back to Washington, the Pentagon, and a climate that coddles eggs.
I like coddled eggs.
You like everything. You are just too good to be true.
How long will you be gone?
Sealed orders, darling. All I know is I'll be home as soon as I can. Now, what will you give me if I give you a basket of kisses?
I'll give you a basket of hugs.
Oh, I like your hugs.
I don't like your kisses, Daddy. You're so big and strong.
I'll miss you. The general doesn't have one pretty girl in his entire staff.
I wish you could have my Daddy. I'll miss you every day.
Will you write to me?
Do you want me to?
Of course I want you to.
Then I'll write to you every day.
Every time I write to Mother, I'll put in a note for you.
Will you really?
Really and truly. And every time the general tells a good joke, I'll send you an official report.
Oh, Daddy, that won't be very often. You better send me the bad ones, too.
Sweetheart, I will. I shall write daily to both my sweethearts. Unless someone starts a shooting war, we all have to go underground.
Would you go underground if there was a war?
Oh, yes, I would. And by gum, I'd go fast.
You said by gum because I was here.
That's right. I did.
Oh, darling, take care.
Darling, I will. Every minute I'm away. I'll wire you the minute we're on the ground. Take care of each other, you two.
We will. Oh, that will be Monica and Emily. They wanted to say one last goodbye to you.
Oh, sure.
Is it all right?
Oh, it's perfect, darling. Braids and all.
Come in, Monica. Come in, Emily.
Wait, because the abusive neighbors from upstairs have to be in on everything. Don't have a life of our own, so we have to live everybody else's way. Now, I'm speaking for myself as well as for my brother Emily, who never gets a chance to speak when I'm around. Well, I guess I talk too much. Say something, can't I?
I'm afraid it'll have to be goodbye. The taxi's here, and I don't want to rush the car.
And don't you worry about your two pretty girls, Kent. We'll keep an eye on them for you. And if one of them begins to look peaked, why, we'll send up smoke signals.
I'm counting on you, Emery. And on Monica.
Oh, goodbye, Kenny.
Well, sweetheart, this is it. Goodbye, big eyes.
Goodbye, Daddy.
Oh, darling, I promised myself I wouldn't.
Don't, sweetie. It's just another empty month or two. We'll get through them somehow.
I'll take those.
Bye.
Oh, poor boy. He hates to go. And you'd hate to let him go.
I'm not very self-sufficient.
Well, I am, and it's not very good. But you're in love. You both feel you're in love. You're lucky characters. I wish I were. Anyway, you don't have to take Rhoda to the bus today. No, I have made some cupcakes for the picnic, and Miss Fern's gonna come by and pick them up.
Oh, good.
Yes. And Rhoda, I have a couple of presents for you.
Presents?
Now, the first one here, it's from Emily. A pair of dark glasses with rhinestone sparkles. He told me to tell you that they are intended to keep the sun out of those beautiful hazel eyes of yours. Go on, try them on. Oh, now who is that Hollywood starlet? Could it be little Rhoda Penmont who lives in the delightful Paris on the first floor of my apartment house? Oh.
I like them.
Oh, good.
Where's the case?
Well, it's right here, honey. And now, this second one's for me. This was given to me when I was 8 years old, but it's a little bit too young for me now, but it's perfect for an eight-year-old girl. See, now, the stone in here, it's a garnet, and we're going to have to change it out for a turquoise, because turquoise is your birthstone. Huh?
Could I have both stones and garnet, too?
Oh, Rhoda, that's not bad. Of course, you certainly may. It's wonderful to meet a natural little girl, not one of these overconfident little pets who have to go to analysis before they can decide what kind of ice cream flavor they want.
Excuse me.
Now, I might be just a little bit behind the times, but Well, you look like a princess in that pretty red and broadened dress, but aren't you afraid you're going to get dirty or scuff up your shoes? Don't most children wear coveralls or something like that for a picnic?
She won't soil her dress or scuff her shoes. Rhoda never gets dirty, though. How she manages it, I don't know.
I don't like coveralls. They're not...
They're not ladylike enough, are they? Oh, you old-fashioned little darling, you.
Am I to keep this now?
Well, yes, you may keep it until I find someone to change the stone down.
Then I'll put it in my box.
Good.
Leroy. I guess I'm pretty early this morning, Mrs. Pennemont, but it's my day for doing the windows on this side.
Yes. You can begin in the bedroom, Leroy.
Excuse me, ma'am.
I like garnets, but I like turquoise better.
Oh, will you just not tap like by Fred Astaire? What have you got on your shoes?
I run over my heels. My mother had a giant piece of pronto that lasts longer.
Oh, I'm afraid I can't take any credit for it. It was Rhoda's idea entirely.
I think they're very nice. They save money.
Oh, you penurious little darling. What was it that I came down here for? The locket and the cigarettes and the... What was it? Now, I think that perhaps you worry too much about having to be the very, very best at everything. So one of the reasons that I brought you those presents, well, Emery and I know how very much you wanted that penmanship medal and you didn't get it.
It's the only gold medal Miss Stern gives, and it was really mine. Everybody knew I wrote the best hand and that I should have had it.
Excuse me, just get some more.
I just don't see why Club Dago got the medal.
Oh, Rhoda. These things happen to us all the time, and we simply have to accept them. I told you to forget the whole thing. Yes, I know. You don't like people pying over you.
It was mine. The medal was mine.
Rhoda, I told you to forget it. Put it out of your mind.
I won't. I won't. I won't.
Oh, Leroy, have you taken leave of your senses? You just spilled water all over her shoes.
Sorry, I was in a hurry.
Leroy, I own this apartment house, and you are in my employ. I've tried to give you the benefit of the doubt because you have a family, but, well, I've always thought that you were emotionally immature and torn by irrational rages and a bit on the, well, psychopathic side. But now I see that my analysis was entirely too mild. Oh, no. You are schizophrenic with paranoid overtones. I'm sick of it. I'm sick of your discourtesy and your surliness and so every other tenant in this building. I want to tell you that my brother Emery has wanted me to discharge you, but for some misguided reason, I've stood up for you, but I will no longer do that.
Oh, Monica, he didn't mean it. It was an accident. I know it was.
He meant to do it. I know you meant well.
Christine, she's right. This was no accident. It was the deliberate act of a spoiled, neurotic child.
He meant to do it. You made up your mind to do it, but through the room.
Rhoda!
I was looking at you when you made up your mind to wet us.
Oh, I never. I'm just clumsy.
Oh, Leroy.
Oh, Leroy, I lost my patience with you. Just go on about your business.
Yes, ma'am. Mm.
He has the mind of an 8-year-old, but somehow he has managed to produce a family. Well. Oh, that must be Miss Fern.
Oh, come in, Miss Fern. We're nearly ready, I think.
I'm a bit ahead of time, as usual.
And this old scatterbrain, why, she left 2 dozen cupcakes upstairs. You won't come up and help me get them?
Yes, of course I will.
Okay, I'll have to excuse us.
Good morning, Miss Fern.
That's a perfect curtsy, Rhoda.
Thank you, Miss Fern.
She does such things well.
She does everything well, as you must know better than I.
Well, then as a person, does she fit in well at the school?
Let me think. In what way, Mrs. Penmark?
Well, Rhoda is, how shall I say this? There's a mature quality about her that's disturbing in a child. My husband and I thought that in a school like yours, where you believe in self-discipline and old-fashioned values, might perhaps teach her to be a bit more of a child.
Yes, yes, I know what you mean. In some ways, in many ways, Rhoda is the most satisfactory pupil that school has ever had. She's never been absent. She's never been tardy. She's the only child in the history of the school to make 100 in deportment each month in every class, and 100 in self-reliance and conservation on the playground each month for a full year. If you had dealt with as many children as I have, you would realize what a remarkable record that is. And she's the neatest little girl I have ever encountered.
Well, Kenneth says he doesn't know where she gets her tidiness. Certainly not from him or me.
She has many good qualities. She's certainly no tattletale.
Oh?
One of the children broke a window across the street, and we knew that Rhoda knew who it was. When we questioned her about it and told her it was her duty as an honorable citizen to report the offender, she just kept right on eating her apple, shaking her head, denying she knew anything about it, and looking us over with that pitying, calculating look she has at certain times.
Yes, I know that look so well.
But even that was admirable, for she was merely being loyal to a playmate.
Then, do the other children like her? Is she popular?
The other children?
Then
I suppose we should be going. My sisters and the others will be waiting. Goodbye, Mrs. Penmark.
Goodbye, Miss Friend. May it be everything a picnic should be.
Thank you.
Yes.
Come, Rhoda.
Yes, Miss Friend.
Oh, well, come see some prosperous boy.
Thank you. We'll take good care of her.
Oh, no time? Well, we stole some time, didn't we?
Oh,
yes, we did.
We're off. Bless you both.
Well, now the oldest set is left all alone. What shall we do?
Well, I suppose I could go through the dreary business of making my face presentable. It happens every morning.
Huh, your face? Honey, think of mine.
I get so funny every time Kenneth goes away. Anything can happen until I see him again. There's an old saying, you die a little at parting.
Well, yes, but we die a little bit every day if you want to brood about it. Now, come on. Let's make a party. You're having Emery and Reggie Tasca over for lunch, aren't you? Well, can't I help with that?
But what do you be a criminologist?
Criminologist? Well, you know, prussic acid, blue vitriol, and ground glass.
The hot weather thing.
Yes, the hot weather. Nothing could harm Rich. You know, he just thrives on buckets of blood and instant death.
How many murder mysteries has he written?
Well, a whole series of his would probably circle the entire Empire State Building. Or me, for that matter. Oh, come on. I'm just a garrulous old hag. But I'll tell you one thing. I know how to grind glass. Come on, I'm going to leave it open. No way.
That know-it-all, Monica Breedlove. She don't think anybody knows anything but her. I sure that picture plenty. And that young, trough-fed Mrs. Penmark. Well, she don't get enough of what she needs. I could give it to her. Rhoda now. That is one smart little girl. She's almost as smart as me. She sees through me, but I see through her. By damn, she's smart.
Choirs.
And what does he do every Sunday?
every Sunday, he gets on a boat with Reggie and a bunch of other men. And they go fishing. Now, are there ever any women at these occasions? There certainly are not.
You're damn right they're not.
Yes, well, I bet y'all are shocked by this, but actually, according to Cowbound, homosexuality is a lot triter than incest. Now, he says that it is an individual choice. One of the things that I discovered to be perfectly frank about myself was that I had subconsciously an incestuous fixation on my brother Emery. Well, it's not normal, but it's the way it is.
Thanks a million, little sister. Can we talk about something normal, like, say, murder? Anybody mind if I smoke a cigar?
What are you trying to prove, Emery?
Let's relax away from over here and have our tea over there.
Well, now, we have gone through sex, so let's talk about homicide. Reggie, you are the expert in that.
Any changes for the better?
All right, I'll oblige. I've been collecting data on a Mrs. Allison lately. News Budget magazine wants an article on her. I can't say she's a very flaming subject. Just an unimaginative nurse who was in a position to kill people off with the life insurance. And ran through quite a list before anyone suspected her.
But was this recent?
Well, last year. And the year before. Well, she'd still be going, but she's too stupid to vary her poisons. Now, as a result, all of her victims had similar symptoms. Nausea, running throat, intestinal pain, convulsions, to say nothing of the conventional life insurance made out to the old girl with the arse.
Oh, please. I don't like to hear such things.
Oh, you don't?
No.
Oh, well, now that's an interesting psychic block. I'd like to be able to get to the root of that anxiety.
I don't know why I have it. I just have an aversion to violence of any kind. I even hate the revolver Kenneth keeps in the house.
Oh, now, do you hate the revolver more than you hate poison?
I hate them both.
Well, we are definitely going to get to the root of this terrible anxiety of yours. I want you to say the first thing that comes into your mind when Reggie tells the story, no matter how silly it is, the very first thing. Reggie, you tell the story and Christine is going to associate.
Oh, nonsense, Monica.
What do you mean associate?
Well, never mind, just you on.
All right. Well, the end of the story is like this. Toward the middle of May of last year, Mrs. Allison went to visit her sister-in-law's family. Now, see, she got there just in time for lunch. And her little niece, Shirley, reminded her that she had forgotten to bring her birthday present. Well, Mrs. Allison was so upset about forgetting the little girl's present, she rushed down to the neighborhood store and bought candy and soft drinks for the whole family.
Now, what do you think?
Nothing.
Well,
actually, she had brought the little girl a birthday present. It was 10 cents worth of arsenic.
Now, what do you associate? Now, what do you see there? Come on.
Well, what I was thinking at the moment was how devoted the Burns sisters were to my father when he was a radio commentator.
I don't understand that. Not yet. What made you think of that?
Well, I was thinking of when they told me when I entered Rhoda in the firm school. They were telling me all about it.
Well,
isn't your father Richard Bravo?
Yes.
I thought so. The whole nation was devoted to him during the last war.
Yes. I listened to Bravo every evening.
Now, Reggie, come on with your story.
All right, now, let's see. When Mrs. Allison returned from the neighborhood store, she opened a bottle of sarsaparilla for her little niece and then watched the little girl's convulsions for an hour.
Now, Reggie, without thinking, no matter how silly this is, what are you thinking? There must be something here.
Well, dear. I always had a feeling that I was an adopted child. The Bravos weren't my real parents.
Oh, you're innocent, darling. Don't you know that the changeling fantasy is the commonest among children? Oh, yes. I myself thought I was adopted. Of course, royal blood, Plantagenet. And my brother Emery here was a Tudor. Now, why did you have those suspicions?
Only I dream about it all the time.
Well, now, what kind of dreams?
Oh, Monica, please. Must I tell my dreams, too? I'd rather hear about murder.
Well, I suppose that would just be fine for now. Reggie, go on with your story, and we'll hear more from Christine later.
And why do you always like to dig into people's insides? Monica, you're a ghoul.
Well, yes, I am, but who isn't? Come on, tell us the final part of this.
All right. Mrs. Allison. Then rushed back to town on an urgent errand. It seems that she'd forgotten to pay the current premium on little Shirley's life insurance. And today was the last day of grace.
That was stupid.
Well, she certainly was rude. But there have been real artists in her line. Real operators. Like Bessie Danta. Bessie never made a mistake. Never left a clue. Never committed the imperfect crime.
Who is this?
Well, only the most famous woman in all annals of homicide, Bessie Danta. Oh, she was beautiful. She was brainy, and she was brutal. You see, Bessie never used the same poison twice. Well, for example, her own father died of rabies, supposedly contracted by a mad dog. And it just so happened that he left all of his money to Bessie.
Oh, did you say Bessie Danker?
Yes.
I think I know that.
I think Christine has had enough of this, Reggie. Could we talk about something else?
We certainly could.
Yes, and we will.
Just don't bother with me. Tell us more about Dr. Catalog.
If you leave it to Monica, she has three subjects, sex, psychiatry, and pills. Now, to her, sex and psychiatry are synonymous, so you best better try pills.
By pills, my brother means the modern pharmaceutical advances that have pushed medicine into this century since 1935, yes. Now, I think, Emery, that you would be a better man if you took some.
Well, we should have gotten into this sooner. I have a lecture at 3:30, and if we get started now, I won't be much ahead of time. Mrs. Pinlock, you'll have to forgive me for filling the air with such horror stories.
Oh, forgive me. I have some phobia or mania. I act quite unreasonable when I hear such things.
Well, I'm sick of the bloody stuff myself. I only keep at it to make a living. So, let's be friends.
Yes, of course.
Oh, I really must be going. Goodbye, Monica.
Oh, well, goodbye, Bluebeard.
Goodbye, Reggie. See you Sunday. I hear the redfish are running.
Goody.
I wonder if it wouldn't be about time for the news. Do you mind, Christine?
Oh, of course not. I'll just clear these off and let me help you with that.
Nothing more important has happened for many years in the field of foreign affairs. I interrupt this broadcast to... I have been asked to announce that one of the children on the annual outing of the Fern Grammar School here in Tallahassee was accidentally drowned in the bay this afternoon. The name of the victim is being withheld until the parents are first notified. More news of this tragic affair is expected momentarily.
No, it definitely was not Rhoda. Rhoda is much too self-reliant a child. It was probably some confused, timid youngster, afraid of his own shadow. It certainly was not Rhoda.
To return to local affairs, I am now authorized to give the name of the victim of the drowning at the Burns School picnic. It was Claude Dagelberg. the only child of Mr. and Mrs. Dwight Daigle of 126 Willow Street. He appears to have fallen into the water from an abandoned wharf on the Fern property. It is a mystery how the little boy got out on the wharf, for all the children had been forbidden to play on or near it, but his body was found off the end of the landing, wedged among the pilings. The guards who brought up the body applied artificial respiration without result. There were bruises on the forehead and hands, but it is assumed these were caused by the body washing against the pilings. And now, back to the national news.
Oh, poor child, that poor little boy.
I assume they're going to be sending the children back immediately. It should be the end then.
This will be the end of the picnic.
Oh, I don't know what to say to her, Monica. Rhoda's 8. I remember I was much older, at least before death touched me closely. A teacher I adored died. My whole world changed and darkened.
Well, I think that we better go. I mean, this is no time for well-meaning neighbors to be standing around on the sidelines.
Monica, I don't know what to say to her.
You'll meet it better alone. Honestly, you will.
Yes, I mean, this is between you and Rhoda. There's nothing that we can do.
Yes, I suppose so.
Children get these shocks all the time. Lots of grim business.
Well, I'm glad you were here. She'll have missed lunch. I'll make her a sandwich.
I will go upstairs just in case if you do need.
Thank you, Monica. Thank you both.
Seems to me you'd be in your room crying your eyes out, or
or else up to the church burning a candle in a blue cup.
Bye, Mother.
Bye, Rhoda.
You ask me? I say you don't even feel sorry for what happened to that little boy.
Why should I feel sorry? It was Claudego who got drowned, not me.
Washington, D.C. Mr. Richard Bravo. Yes? Bethesda 71293. Father?
Oh, I'm so glad I finally found you. I've been trying all evening. Well, you said in your last letter you'd be coming to Tallahassee soon. Are you sure you're well enough for such things? Well, good. Well, it's not very far from here. Couldn't you come see me? Couldn't you come sooner? Oh no, we're both doing well. You saw Kenneth at the airport? How is he? Oh, tell him I love him and miss him very much. But, Father, there's something I wanted to ask you. Do you remember that reoccurring dream I used to have as a child? Well, I'm starting to have it again and again. Well, even the Brodians say, one's dreams can't come out of anyone's past but your own. Is there some deep, dark secret in my past that I don't know about? No, nobody. It's just a dream. Very well, I'll be good. Well, you will come see me. Good. Good night, dear. Steve, I got the note.
We're in such distress, all of us at the school, losing one of our children in that way. I hope you'll excuse us for going over and over things.
Oh, I think everybody's puzzled, worried, and saddened.
I've never known of a happening to puzzle so many people in so many ways, and I can help so few of them. I've just come from seeing Mrs. Dagle. Of course, we thought of her first. The rest of us are touched only lightly by this tragedy. She will have to live with it all the rest of her days.
I know.
I've seen Mrs. Dagle several times, and each time she's asked me to find out from you if you have any possible clue to where the penmanship medal may be.
Was it lost?
It wasn't on the body. It's completely disappeared.
I didn't know of this.
Good morning, Miss Bird.
Good morning, Rhoda.
Mother, could I sit under the stubborn on our quad and read my book?
Of course, Rhoda.
It's shady there, and I can see your window and you can watch it from the window. And I'd like to hear you can see me.
Is that a new book?
Yes, it's Elsie Dinsmore, the one I got for prize at Sunday school.
Oh, well, I'll be here.
I'll be right there all the time. Goodbye, Miss Bird.
It did occur to me that Rhoda might have told you a detail or two she didn't remember when she talked with me. You see, she was the last to see the little Dagle boy alive.
Are you sure of that?
Yes.
I hadn't realized.
About an hour after we arrived at the estate, one of the older pupils came on Rhoda and the little Dagle boy at the far end of the ground. He was upset and crying, and she was standing in front of him blocking his path. The older girl was among the trees, and neither child saw her. The girl was just about to intervene when Rhoda shoved the boy and snatched his medal. The boy broke away and ran down the beach in the direction of the wharf where he was later found. Rhoda followed him, not running, just walking along, taking her time, the older girl said.
Has it occurred to you that the older girl might not be telling the truth?
That is not at all likely. She's one of the monitors we appointed to keep an eye on younger children. She's 15 and has been with us since kindergarten days. No, Mrs. Penmark. The girl was telling us precisely what she saw. We know her well.
And this was the last time Claude was seen.
Yes. A little bit later, it might have been about noon, a guard saw Rhoda coming off the wharf. He shouted a warning, but by then she was back on the beach and he decided to ignore the matter. He didn't identify the child by name, but she was wearing a red dress, he said, and Rhoda was the only little girl to wear a dress that day. Of course, at 1 o'clock, the bell for lunch rang and Claude was missing from the roll. You know the rest.
I know, but this is very serious. If Rhoda was present on the wharf...
Oh, no, not at all serious. If you've seen as much of the way children behave as I have, children conceal things from adults. Suppose Rhoda did follow the Dagle boy out onto the wharf. So many things could have happened, and so innocently, the boy may have concealed himself in the old boathouse, and then when discovered, backed away from Rhoda and fall into the water.
Yes, that could have happened.
Now, Claude, although he looked frail, was an excellent swimmer. And of course, Rhoda knew this. When he fell in the water, she would have expected him to swim ashore. How could she know the treacherous pilings were the exact spot where he fell?
No, she couldn't possibly have.
And perhaps the thought in Rhoda's mind when he fell in the water was that he would ruin his new suit and she'd get a scolding for causing it. And then when he didn't swim ashore, she may have thought with the logic of childhood that he was hiding under the wharf to frighten or escape her. And then when it was too late to do anything, she was too afraid to admit what happened.
So you think there's something Rhoda knows that she's not admitting?
Yes. I think think, like many a frightened soldier, she has deserted under fire. But this is not a serious charge. Few of us are courageous when tested.
She has lied, though.
Is there any adult who has not told a lie? Smooth the lines from your brow, my dear. You're much prettier when smiling.
I'll talk to Rhoda.
I wish you would. I don't know that you'll find out more than you know.
There is something I want to ask you, Miss Barney. There was a floral tribute at Claude's funeral from the children of the firm school. I suppose they shared in the expense, but I haven't been asked to be any part of it.
The tribute wasn't nearly as expensive as the papers seem to think. The money has been collected, the flowers paid for.
Perhaps you telephoned me and I was out?
No, my dear. We thought you might want to send flowers individually.
Why would we want to send flowers individually? Rhoda wasn't friendly with the boy, and my husband and I have never met the Dables.
I don't know, my dear. There are three of us, you know, and in the hurry of making decisions.
You make excuses for Rhoda, and you admit you didn't ask me to pick any part of the flowers, and your reasons for such are very suspicious. Does this mean that in your mind, in the mind of your sisters, there is some connection between the Dable boy's death and Rhoda's presence on the board?
I refuse to believe there is any connection.
And yet you act as if there were.
Yes, I suppose we have.
This is a terrible tragedy for Mrs. Dable. As you say, she's lost her only child. But if there is some shadow hanging over Rhoda from what has happened, I shall have to live under it. And my husband, too. And as for Rhoda, she would not be happy at your school next year.
No, she would not. And since she would not, it would be as well to make up our minds that she will not be there.
So there is a shadow hanging over her, and you've already decided not to invite her back.
Yes, we have made that decision.
But you won't tell me why.
I think her behavior in the matter of the medal should be sufficient explanation. She has no sense of fair play. She's a poor loser. She doesn't play the game.
But you're not saying that Rhoda had anything to do with Claude getting drowned.
Of course not. That possibility never entered our minds.
I should answer that.
Of course, my dear.
Yes.
Thanks. Where Mrs. Dagle and Mr. Dagle. You didn't have to let us in, you know. You realize we followed you here. Shouldn't have done it. I'm a little drunk. Guess you never get a little drunk.
You're welcome.
Oh, both of you pay no attention to him. He's all for good reading. He tried to stop me. Now you, Miss Penmar, you've always had plenty. You're a superior person.
No, I'm not.
Oh, yes, Father was rich. Rich Richard Bravo, I know. Me, I worked at a beauty parlor. Friend used to come there. She looks down on me.
Please, Mrs. Dangle.
It was that grumpy blonde. I've lost my boy. I'm a lush. Everybody knows.
We're worried about Mrs. Dangle. She's under a doctor's care. She's not herself.
But I know what I'm about just the same. Just the same. Oh, may I call you Christine? I'm quite aware you come from a higher level of society. You probably made a debut and all that. I've always considered Christine to be such a gentle name. Hortense sounds flat. Then to me, Hortense, my girl Hortense. He used to sing it and he hasn't got much sense. It's frightening on the privy fence. Children can be nasty, don't you think?
Please, Hortense.
You're so attractive, Christine. You have such exquisite tasting clothes. But of course, you have ample some money to buy him with. What I came to talk to you about, I asked Miss Fern, how did Claude happen to lose the medal? She won't tell me a thing.
I don't know, Mrs. Stagel, truly!
You know more than you're telling. You're a sly one because of the school. You don't want the school to get a bad name. But you know more than you're telling this butter-witted milk Fern. There's something funny about the whole thing. I've said so over and over again to Mr. Daigle. He married quite late, you know, in his 40s. Of course, he wasn't what the fellows call a spring chicken either. Oh, you won't have any more children. No more.
Please, Fortune, take you home where you can rest.
Rest? Sleep? You can't rest at night and you can't sleep in the daylight. You lie and look at the water where he went down. There's something funny about the whole thing, Christine. I heard your little girl is the last to see my Claude alive. We'll be last for about the last few minutes and tell me what she says. Maybe she remembers some small little thing. Maybe some small little thing. I don't care how small it is. You know something? Miss Fern dyes her hair. She knows something and she won't tell me. Only poor Claude. What they do to you?
I'll talk to Rhoda. Oh, Hortense. Oh, if I only knew.
Nobody took the metal off his shirt, Christine. It couldn't have come off by accident. I pinned it on myself. He had a metal clasp that locked in place. It couldn't have come off by accident. Oh, you can wear such simple clothes, can't you? I could never wear simple clothes. I couldn't even buy them. When I took them home, they never did look simple. Such a lovely, dear little boy. He said I was his sweetheart. He said he was going to marry me. I used to laugh and say, oh, you'll forget me long before then, and you'll find a prettier girl, and you'll marry her. Do you know what he said? He said, no, I won't, because there's not a prettier girl in the world than you are. If you don't believe me, as a girl who pleased, she was present at the time. Why do you put your arms around me? You don't give a damn about me. You're a superior person and, oh God, forgive me. There were those bruises on his hands and that peculiar crescent-shaped mark on his forehead that the undertaker must have covered up. He must have bled before he died, that's what the doctor said. And where's the medal? Who took the medal? I have a right to know what became of the penmanship medal. If I knew, I'd have a better idea of what happened to him. I don't know why you took it upon yourself to put your arms around me. I'm just as good as you are. My Claude was better than your girl. He won the medal and she did it. Oh, I'm drunk. Of course, it's a pleasure to stay drunk when your little boy's been killed. Maybe I'd better go home and lay down.
Yes, yes, we'll go home. Lay down there.
Why not? Why not go home and lay down? Goodbye, all.
I'm so sorry.
Oh, who cares what they think?
Oh, that poor woman.
I've tried to think of any little thing I can tell her, but nothing helps.
No, nothing will ever help.
No. I must get that. Thank you for bearing with her and with me.
I will talk to Rhoda. I know there's nothing that can help that poor creature, but I will do what I can.
We must both do what we can. Goodbye, Mrs. Penmark.
Goodbye, Miss Fern. She'll have to live with it till she dies.
Yes, till she dies. Thank you.
Hello? Yes, speaking. Darling. Oh, I'm so glad you called. Oh, the drowning. Oh, no, she's her usual self. She's sitting across the street reading her book where I can see her. I'm waving at her. Oh, really, darling? Oh, that's great. 4 weeks is such a long time. Call me as often as you can. And Kenneth, I love you. Oh no, don't be late. Goodbye, dear. Monica!
Well, yes, just a fluttery one with two really invading conversation. But I have an errand this time. I'm not here just to gab.
Come in, please.
It's Hot Rose Locket that I'm using as an excuse. Well, I finally found a place that would change the stone and clean it all in one day. Of course, they didn't agree to this unusual effort without some, how shall I say it, pressure on my part. I wouldn't have to threaten.
Not really.
Oh, yes, really. You don't know this little busybody. No, I will threaten. I will use my influence. I will use bribery. I will use blackmail. And I have to pull out all of them on poor Mr. Pageson. Do you know that he originally said that it was going to take 2 weeks for this little job?
You came for the locket. I know where she keeps it.
Well, good. So, I told him that I was in charge of the community chest again this year, and if business was all that good, well, I'd be only too pleased to revise the estimate of his contribution upwards by a, well, a considerable amount. Oh, good, you found it. Why, she keeps her things so carefully. Kind of a miserly little delight, huh?
Shall I wrap it?
Oh, no, no need. Just drop right in my purse. Well, I'm off to the air again. I'm sorry to be bursting in here and rushing out just like that.
No ceremony, please.
Oh, of course, no ceremony. Just a little pragmatism. See you later, Christine.
Bye, Monica.
Bye.
Did you want me to come in, Mother? Will you wait?
So you had the medal after all. Claude Daigle's medal.
Where did you find it?
How did the penmanship medal get under the lining of the drawer of your table, Rhoda? Now I want you to tell me the truth.
When we moved to our new house, Camille was stuffing off Auburn, Mother. Cowie, Mother, it's so shady. Green and I love sitting in it.
Answer me. And remember, I'm not as innocent about what happened at that picnic as you think. Miss Furness told me a great deal, so you needn't bother making up any story for my benefit. How did that medal get in that drawer? Certainly didn't get in there by itself. Answer me! Answer me!
I don't know how the medal got there, Mother. How could I?
You know. You know very well. Did you get on the wharf at any time during the picnic? At any time?
Yes, Mother. I went there once.
Was that before or after you were bothering Claude?
I wasn't bothering Claude, Mother. What makes you ask that?
Why did you go on the wharf?
It was real early when we first got there.
Why did you go on the wharf? You knew it was forbidden.
One of the big boys said there were oysters that go on the pilings. I wanted to see if they did.
One of the guards says they saw you coming down from the wharf. He also says it was sometime a little bit before lunchtime.
I don't know why he said that. He's wrong, and I told Miss Byrne he was wrong. He hollered at me to come off the wharf, and I did. I went back to the lawn, and that's where I saw Claude. I wasn't bothering him.
What did you say to Claude?
I said, if I didn't win the medal, I was glad he didn't.
Oh, Rhoda, stop that. I know you're an adroit liar, but you must tell me the truth.
But it's all true, Mother. Every word.
One of the monitors says they saw you try to grab the shirt, grab the medal off Claude's shirt. Is that true? Every word?
Oh, that big girl was married by the mother. She told everybody she saw me. Even Leroy knew she saw me. You see, Claude and I were just playing a game he made up. He said if I could catch him in 10 minutes and touch the medal with my hand, it was like prisoner's base. He let me wear the medal for an hour. How can Mary Beth say I took the medal? I didn't.
She didn't say you took the medal. She said you grabbed at it, and then Claude went running down the beach. Did you have the medal even then?
No, Mommy, not then.
How did you get the medal?
Oh, I got it later on.
How?
Why didn't you tell Miss Fern when she questioned you?
Oh, Mommy, Mommy, Miss Fern doesn't like me at all. I was afraid she'd think bad things about me if I told her I had the medal.
Rhoda, you knew Mrs. Dagle wanted the medal back, didn't you?
Yes, Mother, I guess I did.
Well, then why didn't you give it back to her? Mrs. Dagle's heartbroken. She may never recover from this. Do you know what I mean?
Yes, Mother, I guess so.
No, you don't know what I mean.
But it was silly to want to bury the metal pins on Claude's coat. Claude was dead. He wouldn't know whether they had the metal pins on him or not. Oh, I've got the sweetest mother. I tell everybody I've got the sweetest mother in the world. If she wanted a little boy that bad, why didn't she just take him out of Yorkie's home?
Rhoda! Stop that! You and I have nothing to say to each other. Rhoda, when we lived in Baltimore, there was an old lady that lived upstairs, Mrs. Clara Post. She liked you very much.
Yes.
You used to visit her every afternoon, and she loved to show you her treasures. Your favorite was a crystal ball in which opals floated. She promised it to you when she died. One afternoon, when you were with her, alone, she somehow managed to fall down the back steps and break her neck. You said she heard a kitten meowing, went to see about it, and missed her step, fell down 5 flights of stairs to the courtyard below.
Yes, it's true.
Then you asked your daughter for the crystal ball, and she gave it to you. It still hangs over the head of your bed.
Yes, Mother.
Rhoda, did you have anything to do, anything at all, with Claude getting drowned?
What makes you ask that, Mother?
Come here. Look me in the eyes and tell me. I want to know now.
No, Mother, I didn't.
You're not wanted at the Fern School next year. They don't want you back. I'll call Miss Fern. Ask her to come over.
She'll think I lied to her.
You did lie to her.
But not to you, Mother. Not to you.
Yes, Fern School? Miss Claudia Fern, please. No message. She hasn't gotten back yet.
What would you tell her, Mother?
No, it can't be true. Oh, it can't be true.
Play the game. She's a poor sport.
Honestly, the long
unusual for the likes of them. Well, she makes those others look stupid and stodgy by comparison. Yeah, honey, you want one?
I seem to have quit.
Seem to have quit? Well, if I seem to have quit, well, you hear the repercussions all the way down New Orleans. Oh, no. I'm going to stick with St. Paul. He said something like, it's better to smoke than to burn, yes. Oh, dear. Listen, do you think that Rhoda could stay up just a little bit longer tonight? Have dinner with me?
Hmm? Yes, she could. I've invited Reginald Tosca over for cocktails. And to ask him about some writing I want to try.
Oh, really? Well, that's good. And there's no need to expose Rhoda to all of his strychnines and belladonnas. No. Oh, Rhoda, you want to have dinner with me tonight?
I am. Mm-hmm. May I bring my new puzzle?
Yes, you may. Is that what it was?
I think it must be the best jigsaw puzzle in the whole world.
Leroy.
Oh, Leroy, there's a lot of excelsior.
Oh, well, now, Leroy, you'll sweep that up.
Yes, surely, ma'am.
No, don't bother sweeping in the kitchen. I'll do it.
It was macabeza with all the animals.
Oh, my. There's a cobra on him. I have an aversion to cobras. Must be Freudian.
Things are
all this stuff
gathered around, Mrs. Fenmore.
Come on, now, let him sweep it. Quick. I'm going to check on my simmering meat sauce.
Oh, and spaghetti?
Oh, it is. You prove?
My favorite.
Oh, good. Well, it's nearly ready. You just come on up whenever you want to. Oh.
Mrs. Penmar.
Well, this is the Penmar door. Christine, you have a Western Union. Well, now, excuse me, honey.
Better listen to me if you want to keep out of bad trouble.
What did I do? You know so much.
You picked up a stick. And you hit him. You hit him with it because he wouldn't give you that medal like you wanted. I thought I'd seen some mean little girls in my time. But you're the meanest. You want to know how I know how mean you are? Because I'm mean. I'm smart and I'm mean. And you're smart. And you're mean. And I never get caught. And you never get caught.
I know what you think. I know everything you think. Nobody believes anything you say.
You want to know what you did after you hit that boy? You jerked the medal off his shirt. Then you rolled that poor sweet little boy off the wharf among them pilots.
You don't know anything. None of what you said is true.
You know I'm telling the gods truth. You know I got it figured out.
You figured out something that never happened, and so it's all lies. Take the Celsius down to garage where you can sleep on it when you're supposed to be working.
Well, you ain't no dummy, that I must say. And that's why you didn't leave that stick with nowhere to find it. Oh no, you're too smart for that. Now you washed that stick off real good, and then you threw it in the woods where nobody could find it.
I think you're a very silly man.
It's you that's silly, because you think you can wash off blood, and you can't.
Why can't you wash off blood?
Because you can, and the police know it. You can wash and wash, but there's always some left. Everybody knows that. I think I'm gonna call the police right now and tell them to start looking for that stick in the woods. You see, they got what they call stick bloodhounds. And them stick bloodhounds, they can find any stick they is with blood on it. And you know what they're gonna do when they find that stick you washed so clean? They're gonna sprinkle a special blood powder on it. And that little boy's blood is gonna show up. It's gonna turn a pretty blue color, like a robin's egg.
You're scared of the police yourself. What you say about me, it's all about you. They'll get you with that powder.
As far as I'm concerned, I wish there was more Excelsior. I could use it.
What were you saying to her, Leroy?
My Miss Benoit, well, he was just talking. She said it was a big box of Excelsior.
Just the same, you're not to speak to her. If you do, I'll report you. Is that entirely clear?
I started it, Mom. I told them to puzzle all about Asia. And I hardly know where anything is in Asia.
Very well. But don't speak to her.
Yes, ma'am.
Dark here. You'll strain your eyes working on these things, dear.
Mother, is it true that when the blood has been washed off anything, a policeman can still find it there if he puts powder on the place? Will the place really turn blue?
Who's been talking to you about such things? Leroy?
No, Mommy, it wasn't me. It was the men who were finding Gate Park.
I don't know how they test for blood, but I could ask Reginald Tasker. Or Miss Byrne. She might know.
No, don't ask her. Oh, Mommy, Mommy, nobody helps me. Nobody believes me. I'm your little girl and I'm all alone.
It's not a very good act, Rhoda. You might improve upon it and convince someone that doesn't know you. But at present, it's easy to see through.
Maybe I'd better go up to Monica's and have dinner.
Yes, she said, any time. Good evening, Mr. Tasker.
Good evening!
This is my daughter, Rhoda.
Oh! Well, hello, Rhoda! My, isn't she a little sweetheart?
Thank you.
Oh, now that's the kind of thing that makes an old bachelor wish he was married.
You like those girls
to Oh, it's the best thing left out of the Middle Ages.
I'm having dinner upstairs.
No. Oh, no. Well, that's our law. All our.
You may go now, Rhoda.
Yes, Mom.
Oh. Now, isn't she just a little ray of sunshine?
I've seen her stormy.
No doubt. But she's going to make some man very happy. Oh, just that smile.
Since I called you, I've had a wire from my father. He's coming here tonight. It's been a year since I've seen him.
Bravo's coming?
Yes.
Oh, now there's one man I always wanted to meet.
Well, he might be here before long. He said perhaps for dinner.
Oh, good. By the way, if you're thinking of writing mystery stories, Bravo was quite an expert on crime and criminology early on in his career.
Oh, I know he was.
Before he started covering the wars, he covered practically all the horror cases, from Liam Cold and Lo Ball.
What will it be?
Oh, Jack Daniels.
Good. I'll have one, too. You see, I have a question for you. It's a bit of a psychological question. Only I'm not sure if it's been asked or answered, if it has been until recently.
Well, I may not have all the answers.
Oh, nobody perhaps does, but you see, what I was thinking of writing made me wonder, do children ever commit murder? Or does crime grow, gradually learned as the criminal grows, so that only adults really do dreadful things?
Oh, well, I've thought about that, and yes, children have committed murders. Quite clever ones, too. Some murders, especially the ones that are going to make great names for themselves, start amazingly early.
In childhood?
Oh, yes. Some of the greatest criminals ever were top flight operators before they were out of short pants and pinafores.
They grew up in slums or among other criminals and learned from their environment. Oh, I wonder if that could be Father.
Oh, if it is, I would like to stay and meet him for a moment.
That's understood. Father!
Hello, darling. I'm early.
Oh, you're here. You're actually here.
Well, I guess I'm something of a truant. You said you wanted to see me, and I wanted to see you, so...
I'm so glad. Father, this is Reginald Tasker.
Ah, Mr. Tasker, one of my favorites.
Oh, I put you to sleep regularly? Oh,
sometimes you keep me up at night, sir. That's an impressive research in that classic crime book there.
Well, I've always said the best papers ever written were by Richard Bravo.
Oh, please. Oh, I'm just an old, worn-out newspaper man. I've written myself out, I've talked myself out, and now I'm just drifting around the countryside, working for a second-rate newser.
Oh, tell me, are you really looking into that offside oil?
Well, that's what they've got me doing now, but I took off and left me for the moment anyway. I wanted to see my long-lost daughter.
Oh. Tell me, sir, I've always wanted to ask you, have you ever considered coming back to the criminology racket? There's been nobody like you since you left.
Well, all compliments aside, sir, my later books didn't sell as well as my early books. The war came along, and now I just try to feel old.
Now, you've written some things that will not be forgotten.
Well, let's go.
Oh, and now your daughter's going to try her hand.
At writing? Can you spell?
Oh!
I get so lonely with Kenneth away, so I thought I'd try out to work out some kind of murder mystery in the evenings.
And you're encouraging this competition, sir?
Well, I must admit I was rather stumped by her last question. She was asking me if criminal children are always the product of the environment.
Oh, there's nothing difficult about that, little girl. They are a product of their environment. Always. Christine. May I have some of the Jack Daniels?
Oh,
whiskey,
yes.
That missed, please.
Yes, of course. I'm sorry. Do you really think that children are always a product of their environment?
They're always a product of their environment.
Well, my doctor friends assure me that we're placing too much emphasis on the environment and not enough on heredity lately. They say there's a type of child born with no capacity for remorse or guilt. Born with the kind of brain that was normal for humans 50,000 years ago.
Do you really believe this nonsense, sir?
Well, yes, I guess I do.
I don't.
Well, they say there are people, only a few, that have no feeling for right or wrong.
That's horrible.
Yes. Well, they have committed some pretty horrible things and just kept on looking innocent and sweet.
Well, I would like to examine the evidence first.
Until we do, really not much sense in discussing this matter, don't you think?
Well, I would like to go into that with you, if you don't mind, sir. You see, the clinic I frequent for my research came to the conclusion a long time ago that there are just bad seeds. Just plain bad from the beginning, and nothing can change them.
And this favorite murderess of yours, the one you were speaking of the other day, is she an instance?
Bessie Danker? Was she a bad seed? Well, I guess she could have been, since the murder started so early in her childhood. You see, Bessie earned the title of the destroying angel early in her childhood.
She started young?
Well, the name wasn't applied to her till much later. But you see, Bessie's most famous murder included the use of a poison mushroom called the destroying angel. As some clever reporter transferred the title to her. In fact, it was a colleague of Mr. Brown's, unless I missed something.
Can we change the subject, please, sir?
No, I want to know. What was the rest of the story, Mr. Tusker?
Well, there's the mystery. By the time the authorities got really suspicious, she had disappeared from the Midwest. Just vanished. Oh, she had accumulated quite a fortune by that time.
Did she ever use violence?
Oh. Excuse me, this will just take a moment. You see, Bessie made a specialty out of poisons. Not only the drugs and toxins, but also the lives of the people she wished to kill. Well, it all came to a sudden end when she was indicted for murder again and took all the parts unknown, leaving no clues. It was rumored that she went to Australia. But wait, there was a child, wasn't there? A little girl.
A little girl? I don't remember. That must be the newest addition to the
family. I have one more question. Was she ever found out here?
Oh, not in this country. Three juries took one look at that beautiful face and heard that sweet, innocent voice and said she couldn't have done it.
She wasn't convicted?
Not guilty. Three times.
Did she have an enchanting smile?
Oh, yes. It was dazzling by all accounts.
She was doomed.
Doomed, yes. Doomed to commit murder after murder. Until eventually, she was found out.
She'd been better off if she died young.
And so would a society. But my friends, we're living in an age of murder. In all of history, there have never been so many people murdered as in our century. Add up all the murders from the beginning of time until 1900, then add up all the murders after 1900, and our century wins, all alone. Now, on that merry note, I shall take my leave. I meant not to bother you, and I have just been lecturing.
Well, you got a highly questionable theory there, sir, about heredity.
Yes, I would like to go into that with you when we have more time.
Well, maybe we can do that the next time I'm in town, sir.
Right. And now I must take my leave. I'm sorry. I'm afraid the pleasure has been all mine.
No, not at all. I'll give you a call early in the week.
Good. I'm always back. Good night, sir.
Good night, Mr. Tyson.
Good night.
Bye-bye.
Christine. Are you really planning on writing something?
No, I was just asking questions. You saw Kenneth at the airport.
Yes, I did. I saw him. He's doing well for a fellow that's hot, sticky, and tired. Most of all, lonesome for his wife.
Oh, you plan on going somewhere this summer, and then the sudden change of orders.
Am I looking too close here? Is there something going on in your mind here?
Does it show on my face?
Everything shows on your face. It always does.
Oh, I'm not sure I'm worried about anything. Well, now that you're here, I always felt so warm and comfortable when you were in the room, and you have that same effect now.
Well, to tell you the truth, dear, you've been magical for me. I've always wanted a little girl. And you're everything a little girl could be for an old dad. But Christine, the other night when you found me, what was it that you wanted to ask me?
Let me think. Would you like another drink?
Yes, I guess I will. Let me fix it. Would you like some gin and tonic or some Jack Daniels?
No, thank you.
Well, speak up here. It's between us, whatever it is.
Well, you see, the landlady here is a bit of an amateur psychiatrist, a devotee of Freud, constantly analyzing.
Oh, I know the sort.
Her name's Friedlud. You'll meet her. She's offered a wonderful room for you to stay in while you're here. Rhoda's having dinner with her tonight.
You're going to come out with something.
Yes, well, what I was going to ask you reminds me of her. You see, I confessed to her the other day that I've always had a feeling that I was an adopted child, that my mother wasn't my real mother, and the father who I loved so much wasn't my real father.
What did Mrs. Greenlow say?
Oh, she said it's the most commonest of fantasies. Everyone has it. She'd had it herself.
It is certainly common.
Oh, but that doesn't help me. I still have that fear, as strong as ever, that you're not really mine.
Or has something made you think of this lately? Or...
Yes.
Well, what is it?
My little girl, Rhoda.
What about Rhoda?
She terrifies me. I'm afraid for her. I'm afraid of what she may have inherited from me.
What could she have inherited?
And Father, whose child am I?
My daughter, dear.
Oh, don't lie to me anymore. I told you of my dream, only I'm not too sure it is a dream. I know this is a strange question to greet you after you've been away for so long. Are you my father? Whose child am I? You must tell me. For Rhoda's sake, and for mine, you must tell me.
Well, when has Rhoda died?
I don't know. Then I'm afraid.
Well, why are you afraid? It cannot be inherited, dear. It cannot.
I'm sorry. I won't ask any more questions.
I'm sorry, dear.
Only I have my answer now. It isn't Christine, is it? It's Ingle.
You remember the name?
Yes. It's well, coming back to me. Ingle. Denver! You have concealed something from me all these years. I came out of that terrible place. You found me there.
Christine, please forgive me. Please. It was the neighbors that found me after your mother vanished. And where she had stayed to, I've never known. Nor did the neighbors. She had gathered quite a fortune by then. But something frightened her, Christine. And so she quickly got away. Even one child, Christine, look at me, please. Even one child, a beautiful little thing, with the most enchanting smile I've ever seen. I was covering a case with the Chicago paper at that time, and I wired your mother, my wife, to come and join us. I couldn't resist you, dear, just couldn't.
You should have left me there.
It was the neighbors that found you there and saved you. Would you rather have stayed with them?
No, no, you know I wouldn't have. You've been a wonderful father, but that terrible household, and that evil woman, my mother!
Well now, excuse me, but Rhoda has finished her dinner, tired of her bustle, and now she wants a book to read.
We haven't even started ours yet.
And I haven't met Mr. Bravo. How do you do? I am Miss Breedlove. I'm the oversized analyst. I'm going to be putting you up for a bit, but I promise I will not annoy you.
Well, you know us. You know us. How us newspaper men are here. We're bitter, we're crusty, we're irritable. If you can put up with me, young lady, you're a saint.
Oh, well, saint.
Granddaddy!
Now, isn't she just perfection?
Next to Daddy, you give me the best hug. Why do you look at me?
I just want to look at your face.
Oh, well, Mr. Brown, these Penlocks are the most enchanting neighbors that I have ever had. Now, Rhoda, I'm going to be wanting you up for dinner every single night. Oh, hey, rock the fingerprint series.
I'm afraid I was very guilty of that about 20 years
ago. Oh, my. I just loved that first volume. I read it to pieces. I wept over all my favorite parts until it was, well, illegible. Then I went out and I bought me another one.
Oh, I finally had my puppet.
Well, I hope I don't disappoint. Anyway, I am large.
I just love the way you read books to pieces. Good for royalties.
It is good for royalties.
I'll go see about our dinner.
Well, maybe I should go upstairs and get ready for the evening.
Well, if you'd like to go up right now, I can take you.
If you'd be so kind.
Well, certainly. It's just on the next floor, right above us. Be back later, Christine.
Incinerator?
Yes.
What is it?
Some things you told me to throw away.
Let me see what's in the package.
No!
Let me see it! You hit him with one of these shoes, didn't you? Tell me! Tell me the truth! You hit him with one of those shoes! That's how he got those marks on his head, forehead and his hands! Tell me! Answer me! Answer me!
I hit him with the shoes. I had to hit him with the shoes, Mother. What else could I do?
If you know that you murdered him?
It was his fault. If you would have given metal like I told him to, I wouldn't have hit him.
Tell me everything. Start from the beginning. I already know that you killed him, so you needn't lie to me again. Tell me everything.
I can't, Mother. I can't tell you.
Rhoda, I want... I'm waiting for your answer! Tell me now!
He wouldn't give me the metal like I told him to, that's all. So then he ran away from me here on the wharf. But I found him there and told him I hit him with my shoe if he didn't give me the metal. He shook his head and said no, so I hit him with the shoe the first time. He took off the metal and gave it to him.
Then what happened?
Well, he tried to run away. So I hit him with the shoe again. He kept crying, making a noise, and I was afraid someone would hear him. So I kept on hitting him, Mother. I hit him harder this time. And he fell in the water.
My God. Oh, my God. What are we going to do? What are we going to do?
Oh, I've got the prettiest mother. I've got the nicest mother. That's what I tell everybody. I say I've got the sweetest.
Rhoda, how did he get those marks on the back of his hands?
I tried to pull myself back on the wharf after he fell in the water, but I wouldn't have hit him any longer because he was going to tell on me. Oh, Mommy, Mommy, please don't even let them hurt me.
No, no, nobody will hurt me. I don't know what we're going to do, but nobody will hurt you.
I want to play the way we used to, Mommy. Will you play with me? If I give you a basket of pieces, what will you give me?
Please, please.
Can't you give me the answer, Mother? If I give you a basket of kisses.
Rhoda, go to your room and read. I have to think of what to do. And promise me you won't tell anybody what you've told me.
Why would I tell and get killed?
Rhoda, about Mrs. Clara Post. Tell me what happened. I already know so much. Another won't matter.
There was ice on the steps, and I slipped and fell against her, and that was all.
That was all?
No. I slipped on purpose.
Rhoda, take these shoes! Hurry! Burn them in the incinerator, quickly!
What will you do with the metal, Mother?
I'll think of something to do with the metal.
You won't give it to Miss Byrne?
No. No, I won't give it to Miss Byrne.
DeRoy.
Piano lesson. I haven't got them. I keep telling you.
Bring them back.
schooling at first, but now I really believe you did it. I really believe you killed that boy with your shoes.
You've got them hidden, but you better get them and bring them back here, right here to me.
I'm talking loud. There's someone in the hall.
What were you saying to me, Roy?
Nothing.
I heard you say bring them back here.
He said he had my shoes.
I ain't got nobody's shoes but my own. There's a message from Mr. Bravo coming.
You may go now, Leroy.
But whenever I bully you, you got to know that it's because I love you. I love you truly and deeply, and as if you were my own child, and Emery feels, oh, honey, oh my, what is it? Lord, you can tell me. Come on, trust me. What is it, Christine, honey? Oh, I'm sure you'll be feeling better once you get some sleep, honey. Damn, I'll get rid of whoever that may be. Yes, ma'am?
Oh. Well, Mrs. Breedlove, hi. I realize you don't want me here, and I don't want to be here, but I can't stay away, so I got a little drunk and came over.
Yes, well, certainly.
Like a skunk, I know. Miss Breedlove knows everybody. She knows even me.
How are you, Mrs. Daigle?
Well, I'm half seas over as the fella. I just came by to have a nice little talk with your little girl. She was the last to see my club.
Yes, I know.
Now, where do you keep the perfect little lady that was the last to see my plot? I thought I'd have a folder in my office and ask her a few simple questions and maybe she'll remember some little
thing. She's out playing.
Well, I'm just unfortunate, that's all. Drunk and unfortunate. Only she was right outside when I came by, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, she isn't there now. I can't see her.
She's the perfect little lady, never gives any trouble, that's what I mean. Hey, Christine, have you got anything to drink in the house? Anything at all? I'm not the fussy type. I prefer bourbon and water, but... Oh, hey, we swank. Really? Plaza and Astor? See, I just came over to have a nice little talk with your little girl. She knows something. You know, called Miss Bird over a dozen times on the telephone, and she just gives me the old brush up. That woman does something, all right.
Are you all right there?
I'm not intoxicated in the slightest degree. Kindly don't talk down to me, Miss Penmark. I've been through enough about all that.
I brought back change, Mother.
Very well. Mrs. Daigle wants to speak to you.
So this is your little girl. Claude spoke of you so often and in high terms. You were one of his dearest friends, I'm sure. He said you were so bright in school. So you're Rhoda. Come here, Rhoda. Let me get a better look at you. Come give your Aunt Horton some big kiss. You were with Claude when he had the accident, weren't you, dear? You were the little girl that was so sure she was going to win the penmanship medal and worked so hard for it. She didn't win the medal, did you, Bertie? Claude won the medal, didn't he? Now, tell me this. Would you say it was fair Claude won the medal? Well, he cheated. These things are so important to me now that he's dead. Because if it was fair Claude won the medal, why did you go after him for it?
I want my popsicle.
Yes, of course. And if we're going shopping, we had better leave right away because, well, Mr. Page soon's going to show us all of his collection.
Right now?
Why, yes, as a matter of fact, we're even leaving a little bit late. Now, you got the popsicle. You can come upstairs and wash up to my place.
Well, I must say,
we did have an appointment.
Oh, I'm sure we do. Or practically sure. See, I didn't know Rhoda had all these social obligations. I thought she was like any little girl that stayed home and minded her mother and didn't go traipsing all over town with important appointments. Sorry to interfere with Rhoda's social life. I'll go ahead and apologize to her when I get the chance to interfere.
You didn't interfere at all.
I assure you, I wasn't going to contaminate her in the slightest degree.
Hello? Yes, Mr. Daigle, she's here. No, not at all.
Did he tell him I've been drinking and making a spectacle of myself? Did he tell him to call the patrol wagon?
You heard what I told him. I only told him you were here. He's at the corner drugstore.
I just wanted to ask her a few simple questions.
Maybe another time would be best.
You think because I'm lit, but I'm not lit in the slightest degree. I talked to the guard, remember? He had a long, interesting
conversation, and he said he saw Bill Rhoda on the wharf right before they found my clot among the pilot. She knows more than she's told anybody. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, how can I get rid of this pest? You may have some of that mealy mouth, but you look like Ned in the primer to me.
Maybe you shouldn't come here again.
Oh, I wouldn't come here again for $1 million that I have on the line. I wouldn't have come here if I knew all about Rhoda's social obligations. I won't wait for Mr. Daigle. I'll go ahead and go home myself. I know where I'm not wanted, and I'm not wanted in a place where people have all these social obligations, if you get what I mean. Oh, Christine, you're looking sort of sick and sloppy. Go ahead and come over to my house for a free beauty treatment if you're pressed for any cash. It won't cost you a nickel.
Screaming on and on.
You're not making any sense, honey.
everybody all right?
Just come on in.
It was just a flare-up in the garage, and it's out now, but I guess Leroy...
No, never mind.
You can say it. I know about Leroy. I saw him running down the rock, Bernie. I saw him die. What's worse than that?
I guess you did see the worst of it. It seems like he made a bed out of that Excelsior down in the garage. A cigarette lit pile of stuff.
And Excelsior burns like gasoline when it's dry.
Yes, well, I think that may be the two y'all believe Christine and yourself.
That must be the ambulance.
Let's take care of that.
Yes. Mom, I took a walk from my room, and I lit the Excelsior, and I locked the door.
It was my fault, Mommy. It was Leroy's. He shouldn't have said he'd tell the police about me and give them my shoes.
I know.
There. That's all. Don't let them hurt me, Mommy.
No. Nobody will hurt you. Now, good night, dear.
Good night. Now, will you read to me?
When Polly was all dressed, she bound her shawl and crept very quietly up the room out the front door. The door creaked, and she waited and listened. But nobody woke up. She closed the door carefully and looked out at the bright moon and the cold snow. She could see that there were lights in the windows. She went near the window, and there she saw it, the Christmas tree. Candy and popcorn strings and a silver star at the top. Rhoda. Oh. Rhoda, my little girl. I carried you. You're my love. But I couldn't let them hurt you. They'd only put you in an institution and no one could save you from that. Unless I saved you. Rhoda, dream well, sleep well. I shall sleep too.
Nothing. I don't think it's much good without Christine. The military, career, the promotion. It was Christine that kept me afloat, not any of that.
But she was a wonderful girl.
She's left me, crept away into the earth, and I don't know why. I'm sorry.
Oh, please, no, just cry. Cry all you want to. She was a wonderful girl.
She didn't want to live.
Well, Kenneth, there are things to be thankful for. If we hadn't run downstairs and found her, well, you would have lost Rhoda, too.
Did you like it, Daddy? I played it for you.
Oh, Rhoda. My Rhoda. There's still a little Christine left. It's in your smile.
I love you, Daddy. What will you give me for a basket of kisses?
For a basket of kisses? Oh, my darling, I'll give you a basket of hugs.